Good morning. Good morning. My name is Phil Bertolini. I'm the Deputy County Executive and CIO for Oakland County, and I'm honored to be here on behalf of our County Executive, Al Brooks Patterson. He's under the weather today and couldn't make it, so he asked if I would go ahead and give some brief comments, so I'm going to do that. It's an honor to host the National Association of Manufacturers and their State of Manufacturing event here. I love your shirts, by the way. Manufacturers make America. And that's very personal to me. I'm the son of a pattern maker, and I grew up around the automotive industry on the east side. And I remember my dad gave us three options. He said, look, son, you just can't live in our house and go work at the party store. You either have to go in the military, you can get an apprenticeship, or you can go to college. And at that time, we didn't really understand what that all meant. And boy, has the world changed. Manufacturing is very important to us here in Oakland County. I want to give you a few stats, if I could. And we have a rich manufacturing history and really our future. But we have over 2,000 manufacturing firms in our county. And we've created over 19,000 manufacturing jobs. And that's impressive in a time when we struggled in our industries for so long. But how do we say, you know, why do we do these things? It's because we believe in the manufacturing sector. We believe that our economy has to grow and be diverse. And so if we know why we do it, then here's the what. I'll give you an example, apprenticeships in Oakland County. We have over 2,500 apprenticeships in Oakland County. We have 160 apprenticeship programs that with 63 employers. So the opportunities are there. I just sat in a reception where we talked about 300 and some thousand jobs that are open in manufacturing, and it could be over 1 million in our near future, 2 million. I shows I was trying to listen. But that's big, and for all you young people that are in the crowd, that's huge. And to give you an example, here another what we do is we also have Manufacturing Day here in Oakland County, and it was our fourth year that we've done it. We had 700 high school students tour 35 companies. We had all four of our Oakland schools technical campuses, and we had six school districts actually participate. We have to start young. If we're going to build this sector back up and if we're going to grow what has become something totally different. I mentioned my father was a pattern maker, my dad Ray, and he was a pattern maker when he was working with his hands. He learned with wood, and then eventually computers came in. And here he was in his 60s, and he was trying to figure out how to work computers, and he realized he needed those young people that understood computers so they could build, we could build with our hands. One last thing I would like to share with you about our manufacturing talent here in Oakland County. We commissioned a skills needs assessment on manufacturing. We wanted to know what manufacturers needed. We wanted to compile that information and then hand it over to our educational institutions. And please, for all you young people, just because we talk about skilled trades and we talk about manufacturing doesn't mean you don't need some education and learn the skills necessary to do the job. We even launched mytradeschool.org. It's a web portal for students to actually go out and investigate and learn about manufacturing and learn about different jobs that are out there. You can make an incredible living and do great things with your hands and your mind. Our county has been the great beneficiary of many investments by the companies and many of those represented in this room. And we've had over $1 billion invested this year alone in Oakland County's economy, and much of that is coming from our manufacturing sector. So I'm honored to be here on behalf of our county executive and welcome you all, and thank you to the National Association of Manufacturing for being here with us today. And I'd like to now turn it over to Tom Kelly, the Executive Director of Automation Alley.
Thanks, Phil. Thank you. Thanks very much. All right. Well, you know, we have a lot of Automation Alley members in the audience today, and I just want to say, doesn't the place look fantastic? And I just want to give a shout out to our staff here. The place has never looked better. So thank you very much, Phil, for the warm introduction. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Automation Alley. Phil just introduced me. I'm Tom Kelly. We're honored to have you here today for the launch of the National Association of Manufacturers 2018 State of Manufacturing Tour. I'd like to thank Jeremy Marley, who is here on behalf of Senator Stabenow's office. So thank you very much for being here. For those of you who don't know what we do here at Automation Alley, we are a technology and manufacturing business association representing 800 companies across Southeast Michigan. We bring together industry, academia, and government to help businesses in our region achieve success and think strategically during a time of rapid technological change in the manufacturing industry, known in our parlance as Industry 4.0. Industry 4.0, or the fourth industrial revolution of connected smart factories, has created both immense opportunities and great challenges for manufacturers across the globe as they rethink, retool, and rebuild the way they do business. Think big data, the Internet of Things, the cloud, 3D printing, autonomous robots, virtual reality, artificial intelligence, and so on. As Michigan's Industry 4.0 Knowledge Center, Automation Alley understands that the key to success in Industry 4.0 is dependent on knowledge, not only for business owners, but also for our current and future workforces that will need to be upskilled as factories become more high-tech. And that's what Jay Timmons is here to talk about with you today. How can we inspire a new generation of modern manufacturing talent and showcase how new technologies, including automation, are driving job creation? Mr. Timmons is the president and CEO of the National Association of Manufacturers, the unified voice for 12 million men and women who make things in America. Their mission is to empower modern manufacturers across the country to create jobs, build communities, and strengthen the American economy. We are pleased to welcome Mr. Timmons here today. Under his leadership, the National Association of Manufacturers has earned a sterling reputation in the halls of power and relationships of trust across the political spectrum. Mr. Timmons also serves as the chair of NAM's Manufacturing Institute, the authority on the attraction, qualification, and development of world-class manufacturing talent. Growing up in the manufacturing town of Chillicothe, Ohio, Mr. Timmons understands what this industry means to America. And in this time of change, he and his organization are here to chart the path forward for modern manufacturing and the workforce of the future. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Jay Timmons.
It's a once-in-a-generation opportunity, says Jay Timmons.
The era of economic surrender is over, and the rebirth of American industry is beginning.
The American economy is strong.
Modern manufacturing requires a different type of skill for the future.
These are higher paid jobs. These jobs come from America.
The number of jobs are going to grow and expand.
This country of the United States was not built by those who waited and rested.
Well, Tom, thank you so much for that kind introduction and for welcoming us here to Automation Alley. And I'd like to say good morning to everybody here and thank you so much for being with us. It is a great day to be in Michigan to kick off the 2018 National Association of Manufacturers State of Manufacturing Tour. Over the next 2 weeks, we're going to be barnstorming this incredible country of ours, going from here to Kentucky, to Indiana, Alabama, New York, Kansas, California, and Missouri. And our goal is quite simple, to spend time with the amazing men and women who make things in America so we can be their voice as we tell their story of modern manufacturing. And there's no better place to start than right here in Michigan, where America's manufacturing roots run very, very deep, and where manufacturing workers are building a future like no place else. On this beautiful and frigid morning, we couldn't ask for a better place to get our blood pumping. So again, thanks for hosting us. Now to get us started, I want to salute a few folks who are with us here today. My good friend and partner Chuck Haddon is the president and CEO of our partners here in Michigan, the Michigan Manufacturers Association. Chuck, where are you? Say hey. Chuck, thanks for being here. Really appreciate Phil Bertolini, the Deputy County Executive, for welcoming us here today. And I also want to recognize Irene Spanos for championing Oakland County manufacturing and for being instrumental in bringing us here today. So thank you very much, Irene.
Thanks so much.
And I also want to thank another good friend, Bruce McDonald from Adient, for being a part of our panel this morning. You'll be hearing from him and a few other folks as well. It's also good to see our friends from American Axle Manufacturing, Denso International America, GM, Magna International, Meritor, and a special shout out to our friends at Mahindra. The NAM team was very proud to be a part of the opening of Mahindra's new facility last November, the first new auto plant in the region in 25 years. Many tremendous educational institutions are also represented here today. Thank you for being here. Your role in the new manufacturing economy is absolutely vital. And best of all, absolutely best of all, it's great to have the students who are here with us today. So do me a favor, all the students that are here, please stand up, be recognized. Don't be shy, come on. The future's in really good hands, I can tell you that. We just had an opportunity to meet with the students in another room. And I have to say, and I told you this in the room that we were just in, I'm really excited for you, and I'm a bit envious, because you're the ones who get to live the future of modern manufacturing, to invent it, and to see it in action. So thanks again for being here. But before we get too far ahead of ourselves into the future, ladies and gentlemen, let's talk about the present. What is the state of manufacturing today? Well, today, I'm pleased to report, manufacturing in America is a confident industry. We're growing, we're investing, we're hiring, and we're raising standards of living in communities all across our nation. That's a very different place than we were in just a few years ago. And to put it in Olympics terms, since that does happen to be the time of year, we were strong economically before, but we were barely earning the bronze. Today, we're going for the gold. And that didn't happen by chance. This success is thanks in large part to the work of leaders in the White House and in Congress who've made the American manufacturing worker a top priority. For manufacturers, I want to be very clear about this. It's not about politics or personality or process. It's about policy. The policies of the last year have had tremendous results, produced tremendous results for manufacturers. And that is a fact. But most importantly, it's about the people who make things, and about providing the best environment for their success. As our business climate improves across this country, the need to fill jobs grows. So there's another challenge before us, building the modern manufacturing workforce. The work that happens here at Automation Alley is mission critical to the continued success of manufacturing in America. You're developing talent and forging partnerships to accelerate job-sustaining innovation. Today in America, as you heard earlier, manufacturers need to fill over 364,000 jobs. Over the next 7 to 8 years, we're going to need to fill about 3.5 million jobs, according to a study from Deloitte and the NAM's Manufacturing Institute. But 2 million of those jobs, as you heard, will go unfilled because we haven't upskilled enough workers. 2 million unfilled jobs. Now, outside this room, there are probably skeptics who are going to wonder, how can you talk about job creation at a place called Automation Alley? But here's what you might not read about in the news. Automation and job creation, they're not at odds. Not in the least. American workers and American technology are not enemies. Innovation and automation are expanding what American workers can do. They're making the impossible possible and transforming our industry for the better. We've seen, for example, how automakers use technologies like augmented reality to test new assembly methods and improve ergonomics for their workers, improving both health and efficiency. It's really simple. Automation means jobs. Here in Oakland County, home of Automation Alley, as you heard earlier, there have been more than 19,000 manufacturing jobs added since the Great Recession. That's a growth of more than 40%. Innovation is changing the way our industry looks, but it doesn't change what's at our core. Men and women who have lent their talents to build something bigger than themselves. People finding purpose in making things that truly matter. So the challenge today, it's not a shortage of manufacturing jobs, far from it. The challenge is that the type of work in manufacturing is shifting. It's not about white collar or blue collar. It's about new collar jobs. Jobs that are high tech, 21st century, rewarding, well-paying jobs, and many that don't require a four-year degree. But ironically, if I ask a room full of parents, and in fact students a lot of times, if I ask parents if they want their kids to go into manufacturing, the best I usually get is just a smattering of raised hands, a couple of raised hands. At the NAM, we launched our Creators Wanted campaign last year for exactly that reason, to have real people from real manufacturing jobs talk about what their jobs really mean. Manufacturers are making life-saving medicines and life-changing technologies. They're revolutionizing food production to feed an ever-growing world. They're making our societies more sustainable and transforming the way we commute and communicate. Now, thankfully, you don't have to be a politician or a lawyer to make a positive difference in our world. If you want to create change, be a manufacturer. You might work for an iconic brand or maybe an upstart small business, but the opportunity is there, whether you're unemployed or underemployed, whether you're looking for a new career or your first career. Today looks very different from yesterday. Tomorrow will look far different still, and in ways we simply can't imagine yet. How will artificial intelligence further augment the jobs of a talented workforce? How will augmented reality enhance a worker's ability to solve complex problems? How will quantum computing power a quantum leap into the future? How could blockchain revolutionize the supply chain? We can't answer those questions just yet, but there's no question that reaching our potential and harnessing technologies for good will require lifelong learning and technical literacy. The nature of work is changing, so we have to rethink models of learning as well. We were very encouraged last year when the White House and the Labor Department announced that they would prioritize apprenticeships in America. It's a model that has obviously served well here. It's also served other countries very, very well. It gives people the chance to earn while they learn, both on the job and also in the classroom. At the NAM and the Manufacturing Institute, we've been able to partner with the Trump administration to create a new NAM-recognized system that promotes flexibility and participation. The demand is there, but frankly, we're nowhere close to having the number of apprenticeships or the robust system that we really need in this country. According to Oakland County's Skills Assessment Survey, about half, or 48% of manufacturers, say that they need more trained engineers and designers on their team. An apprenticeship program is one of the ways that we can help fill that need. You know, we often talk about workforce issues as if they somehow exist in a vacuum, detached from other policies that also impact day-to-day operations and the business climate. But the fact is, all policies, that manufacturers care about are workforce issues, all of them. They're about getting workers bigger checks, better jobs, better technology, and more opportunities to sell the products that, they make. So taxes and infrastructure, regulations, energy, trade, immigration, all of these will determine the success of the modern manufacturing worker. Over the last year, leaders in Washington, driven by vision from the White House, have transformed the business climate in America in rapid fashion. They made 2017 the year of the manufacturer, not just with their words, but also with their actions. Manufacturers and manufacturing workers haven't had a president or an administration so focused on our success in quite a while. For instance, it's simply not possible to overstate how much tax reform matters to the future of manufacturing. For decades, we just weren't playing on a level playing field. While we assumed America's economic engine couldn't be challenged, other countries, they got smart. They lowered their tax rates so they could win jobs, so they could win business. But now, manufacturers in America are empowered to compete and win, thanks to tax reform. In fact, in our latest Manufacturers Outlook survey, which we do every quarter, and we've been doing for 20 years, we've never seen numbers as high, optimism so robust. 63% of manufacturers say that they will spend more on their facilities and equipment because of tax reform. 54% say they're going to hire more workers, and over half say they plan to increase wages and benefits. We've seen a lot of great headlines and stories from businesses investing in their workers and their communities. But ladies and gentlemen, let me assure you, that is just the beginning. We want to look back 10, 15, 20 years from now, from this day, and we want to be able to see what a difference tax reform made in the lives of working families. We will create more jobs and hire more skilled workers. We will invest in more plants and attract more investment to our shores. And we will enhance pay and benefits. This is a promise that manufacturers made to our policymakers when they gave us these vital tools to increase our competitiveness. And ladies and gentlemen, we will deliver. For now, the most important fact is that the manufacturing economy in America, from Michigan to Mississippi, from Maine to California, is on a more solid foundation. And we're excited about the possibilities of the future. Now, you may also have heard about the breaking news coming this morning from the White House on its plan for investment in infrastructure. And no doubt about it, for manufacturers, infrastructure is absolutely the next big thing. Bridges, roads, ports, pipes, pipelines, waterways, the electric grid, broadband, you name it. It's time to build it, and it's time to rebuild it. The painful truth is that America just doesn't lead the world on infrastructure anymore. Not even close. And that has big consequences. Shipments delayed, customers inconvenienced, work hours lost. Above all, it's a risk to our families when we're relying on infrastructure built for another generation, a bygone era. The NAM released our Building to Win plan more than a year ago, an agenda that was warmly embraced by the Trump campaign and the Trump administration and used as a guidepost by them and Congress. It's estimated that until 2025, families will lose $3,400 each and every year because of deficient infrastructure. And by 2026, just 8 years from now, that cost is going to rise to a staggering $5,100 wasted every single year. Waste. Money that can be used for so many other things, more productive things. The administration has already delivered on some really important permitting reforms to projects that get them back on track. Now the president is calling for a substantial $1.5 trillion investment is the kind of leadership manufacturers have waited a very long time for, and it could help us reclaim our rightful place as the global leader on true 21st century infrastructure. Manufacturers stand ready to work with Congress and the Trump administration to deliver a tremendous plan that will literally get America moving again. Infrastructure is also a very critical part of improving manufacturers' access to reliable and affordable energy. Over the last year, the administration has taken bold and unprecedented steps to expand energy development here in the United States. And that's game-changing for manufacturers, because we are an energy-intensive industry. Though at the same time, which is kind of a paradox, and it's pretty exciting when you think about it, we've made great strides in efficiency and sustainability. Over the past decade, the United States has made greater reductions in greenhouse gases than any nation on the face of the earth. And manufacturers have been a driving force behind that. We've reduced emissions by 10% in that time, even as the value to our economy has increased by 19%. So we are proving that environmental stewardship and economic growth can and should go hand in hand. But it's not just about consumers, it's also about a national security imperative. To restrict our ability to develop our domestic energy resources is equivalent to subjecting our national economy to the whims of hostile regimes. Today, thanks to new technology and a more balanced regulatory climate, the United States is on track to be a net exporter of energy for the first time in our lifetimes. Think about that. Think about the change that technology has brought about. And I'm going to say that energy manufacturers, by the way, are not the only ones who want to increase exports. Indeed, much of the manufacturing growth that we've achieved in recent years is a direct result of our existing trade relationships, which support more than 6 million manufacturing jobs in our country. U.S. exports of manufactured goods to Canada and Mexico alone support the jobs of more than 2 million people at more than 43,000 manufacturing companies across the United States. So let's be clear, though. Manufacturers always want, we always want, America to negotiate the best deal possible. After all, 95% of the world's customers live outside of the borders of the United States. So as our negotiators in Washington are working to update NAFTA and challenge harmful market distortions from China and elsewhere, we need to do so with an eye to securing strong tools to enforce the rules. The goal must be to ensure manufacturers and manufacturing workers in America are not forced to bear new costs or burdens that would make us less competitive in a global economy. And we know that that can be done. Oakland County is a perfect example of the benefits of trade in a global economy. In just the last 4 years, you've seen more than $1 billion of foreign investment from 13 countries. That accounts for nearly 6,200 new or retained jobs. That is quite an impressive record. And just as you're proud of that fact, communities all across the country are looking to you for that example, because we want more of exactly what you've achieved here. And we want more chances to sell our products outside America so that we can create more good jobs right here in America. Now, no doubt the United States is a trading nation. That's in our DNA. But you know what? We're also a nation of immigrants. And those immigrants, our friends and our neighbors, they're part of our workforce. They lead some of our greatest companies. They founded some of our biggest brands. So for manufacturers, getting immigration reform passed, and frankly, most urgently, finding a solution for the Dreamers, it's as much of a moral issue as it is an economic issue. We simply cannot rob people of the only country and communities that they know, and we cannot rob our country of some of the hardest working people that we know, that is just not who we are as a country. So I joined manufacturers all across this nation who have united to say to Congress, stop playing politics with people's lives. Get this done. Get this done so we can build an immigration system that rightly ensures our nation's security while also welcoming hardworking people who want to contribute to this country and strengthen our collective soul. Now, with all that in mind, there's a lot of opportunity ahead of us, but there's also some challenges. There are those who want to hurt manufacturing in America, who want to profit at our expense. There's a growing trend, an alliance of activists and plaintiffs' attorneys and politicians who are going after manufacturing companies with frivolous and misguided lawsuits. Their goal, the goal of the lawyers, is to make money. The politicians, they want to make headlines. And they want to do it at the expense of manufacturing workers in America, and that is not right. At the NAM, we're not letting this attack on our companies and our workers go unchallenged. We launched the Manufacturers Accountability Project to hold the bad actors accountable. We're going to fight back because there's too much at stake. Jobs, communities, the economic might of our country, it's potentially all in jeopardy. And we do not intend to let that happen. Ultimately, the goal of manufacturing in America is to improve the human condition. And we need everybody to be focused on the success of manufacturers in America. Because manufacturers want to be in the business of lifting everybody up, leaving no one behind, of advancing the values that make America exceptional. Free enterprise, competitiveness, individual liberty, and equal opportunity. That, ladies and gentlemen, that is our history. And that's our mission for the future. I want to invite you to learn more and join us in this work. I'm going to invite everybody in this room and those that are listening from afar to text the word MFG jobs to 52886. That's MFG jobs to 52886. Be a part of our manufacturing army. Manufacturers build better lives with the products that we make, and we provide incredible livelihoods with the jobs that we create. We give people work that provides meaning and purpose, that offers not just a paycheck, but the satisfaction of having created something that matters, oftentimes something that changes the world for the better. Anyone can imagine the future. Anyone can be a visionary. And America has certainly been blessed with some of the best minds the world has ever seen. But while anyone can imagine the future, it takes a manufacturer to build it. So we're determined to do everything in our power to ensure manufacturers are indeed ready to build the best future that anyone can imagine. And again, I thank you all so much for being with us on this outstanding kickoff for our 2018 State of Manufacturing Tour. I salute you for your commitment to manufacturing, and I look forward to speaking with you more from the panel this morning.
Hey, great job, great job. All right. Okay, so we're going to, that was a great speech. Thank you very much, Jay, and we're so delighted that you're here. I'd like now, like to ask Patrick Meza to come on up to the stage. Patrick from Athens High School. Mr. Bruce McDonald, the CEO of Adient, is going to join us. And Carolyn Lee is the Executive Director of the Manufacturing Institute. And I will invite myself as well up to the stage. So, that was a short walk. I think we can manage it. Thank you guys for being here. So I'd like to start with you, Jay. I have a series of questions that I was working on, and the first one I'd like to ask you, and we'll ask everybody questions here. You talked about the threat to manufacturing from outside forces like these frivolous lawsuits that you talked about. Do you want to expand on that point? And for this audience, you know, a lot of the manufacturers here today, and especially small ones, why should they be concerned?
Well, I think every American should be concerned because these lawsuits, these trial lawyers, if you will, and others are working overtime to enrich themselves, to make headlines at the expense of the American economy, at the expense of manufacturing workers, the expense of our communities. They are, for instance, they're suing energy companies over the issue of climate change and trying to make them responsible for an issue that we all know is one that we all have to work on, but they have no standing, they have no grounds for doing this, and it's not as if the American people have turned their head on the need for energy. So that's happening in New York, it's happening in 7 localities in California, and all it's doing is creating more work for the lawyers, instead of using resources to solve the issues and to build that bridge to the future that we all are seeking. So those are resources that can't be invested in new plants and equipment. They can't be invested in the manufacturing workforce. They certainly can't be invested in pay and benefit increases. So we're very concerned about this trend that is starting to emerge.
Yeah, and you know, we sent some of that from our members, those very points, so I appreciate that. Well, in the interest of time, we're going to keep asking as many questions as we can, and we'll come back to you in just a minute, Jay. So Patrick Meza from Athens High School, I just want to preface my question by saying your answer is representative for millions of students, so please be careful with what you say. And we are streaming live, so no pressure. But Patrick's up here because he can handle the pressure so well. So as you prepare for your career, Patrick, where do you see yourself in the manufacturing industry? And maybe what kind of job do you hope to get?
I see myself definitely going into mechanical engineering, industrial and systems is also something that interests me. I look to help within the manufacturing industry. I look to make systems more efficient. I look to design systems. I see myself building the next big thing, and without advances in manufacturing, without me helping out with that, I feel like we won't advance at a rate that we'll be happy with. So definitely I see myself in the near future working on projects, working even maybe for myself one day, hopefully. I see myself doing bigger things.
That's fantastic. I think there's a lot of manufacturers here that'll be asking for your resume.
And you kind of had an idea of what you wanted to do, but then you actually saw it in action, right?
Yeah. Yes.
So that kind of exposure really helps. I know Carolyn is the director of our Manufacturing Institute, and we have Manufacturing Day activities all across the country. And what was the number here? 35.
You had about 30 plus events here in the county.
Absolutely.
And you had what Phil
65 different schools.
Yes. Going. So it's the scene and being firsthand, seeing the opportunity. And you talked about too, Patrick, earlier, listening to other people talk about the different roles you have and opportunities and what that did to change your trajectory too.
Correct.
So we're kind of having this little colloquy here because we have all these students with us today, and we want to get you in the manufacturing workforce. So we're trying to give you some ideas of how to get exposed to all
That's
the great
right.
opportunities.
And we had about 70 students attend Integrate, which is the conference on how Industry 4.0 is washing over manufacturing. Because those technologies are sexy as all get out when you talk about robotics and 3D printing and all the things that people want to do. It really makes it exciting. So Bruce, let me ask you, by the way, Bruce, CEO of Adient, congratulations on that big win with Boeing. That was a huge deal. That's gonna really help our region. So I want to say thank you for that, and thank you for all you're doing. So there's more exciting news. You're actually moving a portion of Adient to downtown Detroit. So tell us about that and the opportunities and workforce you see.
Yeah. So we, we have a number of facilities for, I think 5 or 6 sort of, I'll say white collar facilities here in Michigan. And we were getting to the point where we need to add some people. And I guess what we wanted to do is sort of look to sort of get our people in fewer locations, you know, promote collaborative space, you know, change the layout of our offices to sort of how people are working today, especially, you know, the young people that we're trying to attract to our company in the future. And as we sort of looked at, you know, the office space that was available, you know, up here in Troy or along the 696 or 275 corridor, looked at a number of facilities, and, you know, when I started asking the real estate broker that was showing us around, you know, I'd say, well, you know, who was here before and, you know, where are they now? And it's like, well, this is, you know, Fifth Third Bank and they moved downtown, or this was this company and they moved downtown. And so, you know, after hearing that sort of a few times, I thought, you know, I said to our guy, well, it seems like everybody's moving downtown. Maybe we should go take a look down there. And, you know, at first, our organization, didn't really embrace it, but we found a great building downtown, a historic building that we're going to refurbish back to the way it looked when it was first built back in 1910. And we'll move about 550 people downtown. That'll be sort of our global headquarters. So we did it for, you know, take part in the rejuvenation of this city. Is a great way for us. You know, we're a new company. We spun out from Johns Controls, and it was a great way for us to get our brand out there. And then as we think sort of longer term in terms of the ability to attract a younger, diverse workforce of the future, because a lot of our people downtown be sort of engineers, IT, accounting type folks, and, you know, going around to universities and talking to students, I mean, they don't want to work out in the suburbs and have a house. They want to move downtown where the action is, where they can walk to things. And so that's kind of what the drivers were for us. So we're really excited about it. It's going to take us a couple years to get our facility fully renovated. But, you know, we're proud to be part of Detroit's rejuvenation.
Well, congrats for that. It's really fun. So Carolyn, I'm so glad that we finally, you're way over there. So if I'm not loud enough, let me know. But what's exciting is, Carolyn, you are the executive director for the Manufacturing Institute, which is sort of the nonprofit arm of NAM. Tell us about the Heroes Make America program, which is so awesome. It's the Institute's work with veterans. You want to tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's great. I'd love starting off with that because it's something that all of you have touched on. We need workers. Jay talked about the stats. We're going to have about 2 million unfilled jobs between now and 2025. That's enormous, right? And so part of our mission, what we do at the Institute, our job is to attract, train, and retain the workforce we need. We were founded to foster manufacturing competitiveness, but how can you do that without the people? Because we are at the center of what makes companies successful. Mm-hmm. So as we looked down, we saw this need, we saw the challenge that we have with the workforce, and we thought, you know, how do we find people who can be trained, who can collaborate, who can work on a team, who can communicate? And how do we make sure that they can show up on time, right? Because while I hear, and one of the students said this before, that he wanted to go into, I think, jet propulsion, which is awesome. And, you know, we talk to companies and they say, we need people who are going to show up on time, and I need a nuclear physicist, right? And that is the span of these things. So at the Institute, we thought about it and said, how do we find more workers? Well, we got to start with all the students. We got to start with fifth and sixth graders to get them interested in the first place. Things like Manufacturing Day, so key in that. But then we realized there's 200,000 service members leaving the service every year. And so how do we take them and open the door for them and build that pipeline for them, mm-hmm. from military to manufacturing? And so if we start with the Army, and we're in Fort Riley, Kansas, which is in the middle of Kansas. And we're going to move on to Texas, Fort Hood, later this year as well. But it's this opportunity where, what do you do in the Army if you're an enlisted soldier? You're trained, you work on a team, you focus on mission, and those are all the things that manufacturers need. So we're really excited about it. We're looking to, we have a small class. Our first class is 13 soldiers. Jay and I had the chance to be out there with them for the launch event, and it was awesome. I mean, just truly inspiring. And knowing that we're going to take and help these people who have served their country and who volunteered, most of them right out of college, out of high school, who enlisted, and build that pipeline into manufacturing, and then build it on from there.
And when we were there, there were more companies than students waiting to recruit these military personnel into their company. And who should, here's a shameless promotion, who should companies in this audience contact if they want to be a part of the Heroes program, because I think it's just really awesome.
Yeah, absolutely. And it is a shameless promotion, and I love it. It's heroes, so heroes@nam.org, and we'll connect you in. Because even though we're doing this in Kansas and Texas, these soldiers, as Jay said,
right.
The companies are fighting for them, and these and they're all men right now, so I can say these guys are all looking to go to where home is, to where family is, and some of them want to stay in Kansas or stay in Texas because of the opportunity, but also as they look out and they want to go back as they finish their service, we want to find a place for them to go. And so, yes, absolutely, email us at heroes@nam.org. And we'll help plug you into the program, especially as we expand nationwide.
Great program. Yeah, that is a great program and worthy of a round of applause. So Jay and I were waiting to come on. We were talking, and Jay was telling me all the your tour. This next it's like a USO tour. Every day a different city. Every day something new. So based on all the places you're going to go and what you're going to see. You know, what do you hope to learn from this tour? What do you hope to take back to Washington with you?
So, as I said, the tour is really about people. Not only the people in manufacturing, but the people that we hope to encourage to be a part of the manufacturing workforce. So what Carolyn and I spend a great deal of time doing is making sure that people understand what modern manufacturing really is all about. So having the opportunity to tour plant floors, shop floors, to have the opportunity to meet with community leaders, to have the opportunity to meet with parents and students, to get an understanding of what their perception is of manufacturing. And oftentimes, as you know, it's not reality. Mm-hmm. Carolyn comes from a manufacturing family. My grandfather was in manufacturing. And the manufacturing of our parents and our grandparents simply doesn't exist anymore. And by the way, that's a good thing, mm-hmm. because those were very rough jobs, physically demanding jobs that technology has enhanced and helped make safer, more productive workplaces. Mm-hmm. So we want to make sure that folks really do understand what modern manufacturing is all about. We want to connect students and parents to local manufacturers. We want to connect them to institutions of higher education and trade schools, and make sure that they understand that this pathway is a tremendous path forward, high-paying jobs, and a lifelong career that can really enhance their family's quality of life.
Mm-hmm. And I think what's so funny to me is I have two young children, 11 and 9, my manufacturing love, I sort of talk to them about what their careers may look like. They said, I don't know if I want to do that.
Right.
But said, then they'll go down and they'll get on the Xbox and they'll play Minecraft.
Isn't that amazing?
And they'll be building these vast virtual worlds, and they're doing simulation, they're doing modeling, they're doing 3D and AR and all this cool stuff. And they're even doing manufacturing, because as an example in Minecraft, they say, well, you can't just get a sword. You have to mine the iron ore, then you have to smelt it. And I'm like, oh my God, you're doing manufacturing virtually,
and
you don't know about it.
I'm going to be calling you over the next few years, because my daughters are a little bit younger, so I'm going to need some advice moving
Absolutely.
Forward. I've got an 8-year-old and a 6-year-old, but I've also got a 2-year-old son, and it's fascinating when you see. You often see, and I talk to teachers about manufacturing, and we live in a suburban area, and so they're not thinking of that. They're thinking in terms of liberal arts, and they're thinking in terms of lawyers and doctors. And believe me, we need lawyers and doctors, obviously. Mm-hmm. Actually, we need doctors. Not so sure about lawyers. but what fascinates me is watching my two daughters. My oldest daughter is... I can already tell she's going to be an author, right? Mm-hmm. She likes to write. She likes to read. My youngest daughter loves math and science. Mm-hmm. She loves to build mm-hmm. things and create things. And I just want to translate that into mm-hmm. a manufacturing mm-hmm. career, because I know my kid is going to invent the next great thing, and I'm hoping that every other parent in this country thinks the exact same thing.
And here. Cheers to that. Mm-hmm. So, Patrick, based on everything you're hearing and as we discuss sort of manufacturing, you've sort of taken it all in. There's a lot of your peers are here. What is it that we're missing? What is the message we need to be giving to students that are in high school and maybe even younger to say, everything you love doing, it's available to you in the real world. What would you say about that?
I would say one of the biggest things right now that we're missing is with STEM programs, just the opportunity to go out and see what jobs exist. After going out to many manufacturers and like looking at what jobs are available to, for say, an engineer, you can be very, you can have very different hobbies in your off time, and you can incorporate that into your everyday job. And I feel like students, they don't get to see that. They just get to see the raw, this is engineering, this is how it is, that's it. I feel like we need to be more hands-on also. So many opportunities for, say, companies coming out, showing off small projects, showing off what manufacturing could look like. There's just not a lot of that. I myself realized that. Many of the opportunities came a little later in high school, so sophomore, junior year, those opportunities came by. And I feel like that's a little too late. I feel like we need to plant that seed. Probably fifth, sixth grade is when we start to see what we want to do with our lives. And I don't feel like we should stop there, but just keep going with that for all throughout high school, even into college. I feel like those opportunities should exist. Internships, those are huge right now. I myself applied to a few. It's very important. It's very important for people to see and feel what it is that they would be doing for 20 plus years of their lives.
Right. Thank you. That's a great response. By the way, I want to remind everybody, and maybe Jay and Carolyn and Bruce know this. First Robotics, they're in this summer is going to be coming to Detroit, and they get 40, 50,000 people to these robotics events, and we are so fortunate that First Robotics has chosen Detroit as the host city, I believe for the next couple years. I don't believe it's just for this year. So we're so pleased. I think for the students that are here or listening, what a great event to go out and see how much fun it is to be working with these robots. So Bruce, I have a question piggybacking on Patrick. What technologies have you seen within Adient that kind of empower the workforce and the cool technologies that are impacting manufacturing?
Yeah, some of the panels talked about how manufacturing is a lot different than it was when they grew up or their parents. And, you know, I can only imagine what it's going to be like, you know, in another generation from now. Because, you know, things like the way materials moved around in our facilities, you know, gone are sort of the days of, you know, forklift drivers. It's now automatic or AGVs, automated guided vehicles. And even those are changing from having sort of wires in the factory floor to being GPS controlled things that are smart enough to move around the factory. Automation on the assembly line. So things, you know, jobs that are tough in terms of lifting or the ergonomics, you know, those types of things being automated and you get the quality. And then you look at the sort of people that are on the factory floor, and you know, again, it used to be, you know, one or two supervisor type positions, and most of the people being sort of, you know, direct labor workers. Now the ratio of support staff, of computer programmers or technicians that are keeping the automation up and running to the workforce, you know, totally different. And then lastly, I would say huge change in the way the direct manufacturing employee works from being in a very command and control type structure to much more team-based, collaborative, you know, work cells with self-guided teams and taking away, you know, layers of management that, you know, quite honestly don't know how to work the assembly line as well as the people that are on it. So, you know, just an awful lot of changes. And, you know, my mind, you know, when you start thinking about 3D printing and some of the ways we're going to be able to use the you know, big data and things like that to, you know, preventatively control our equipment and things like that. I mean, it's really exciting, and it's hard to quite honestly get your head around. But you know, change is ever constant, and I mean, the pace of it's quicker and quicker.
Yeah, and so before I open it up to the audience for questions, the one point I want to make, Bruce, is we had a great conversation about the work you're going to be doing with Boeing and lie-flat seats. Yeah. And what blew my mind is lie-flat seats on a plane you're going to have lie flat seats in the car pretty soon. When you think about what a car is capable of, you lay the seat down and it drives you to Chicago or wherever you're going. It blows our mind what's possible in manufacturing.
For sure.
And to be a part of that is going to be exciting.
Absolutely. And you know, and this is obviously the birthplace of the automotive industry for the world right here. And you think about the changes that we're going to see in automotive industry in the next generation around autonomous vehicles, and you know that's going to play a big part in society. I don't think it's going to replace the private car, but it's sure going to be a big part of urban transportation in high density areas. Electrification, so the, you know, traditional powertrain is going to migrate away from mechanical engines to electrification. That's going to happen for sure. And then the things around connectivity, the things you're going to be able to do in your vehicle. The willingness to spend more time in your vehicle because you're not driving it will change the way we work and play. So I think, you know, young people, when I talk to young people, want to work for a company in an industry that they can contribute and make a difference to society. And you know, I think the automotive industry right now, we're facing like when Henry Ford joined, you know, started sort of the Ford Motor Company here. I mean, the changes that we're going to see are going to be that profound, and I think that's going to attract a whole new body of people into our industry. Yeah. It is, with tech companies.
Fantastic.
And you know, we can beat those guys.
Yeah. So I want to make sure we have time to ask some questions from the audience. Does anybody have any questions? And I believe there's mics on either side. We hope you take advantage of it. There's one in Dan. Okay, great.
Patrick, what year are you in? Are you a senior?
Yes, I am. Yep.
Okay, so you're really ready to go.
Correct. Yep.
Now, what made you choose an education in the manufacturing industry?
My dad kind of led me toward that. My dad was a mechanic for a very long time. Currently, he owns a construction company. And I've always seen him work with his hands. It's always been making stuff. And ever since I was like 5, he's always taken me to work. He showed me basically what he does. And I wanted to do that. I wanted to make the next big thing. I wanted to improve stuff. For me, the reason I choose mechanical or industrial and systems engineering is because I like to make stuff more efficient. I like to make stuff be easier for somebody to use. And that's definitely driven me toward the career path I have chosen.
Hi, good morning. Thank you everyone for being here. My name is Chris Trombley. I'm the founder of Zero Defect Manufacturing. We help manufacturers on their Industry 4.0 initiatives. And I have a question for either Jay or Bruce. How do you guys support equipping the workforce for tomorrow's technology and opportunities?
I talked a little bit about the changes in the technology that we're seeing on our shop floor. You know, for us, the biggest source of talent, and you know, Jay talked about the shortage of workers that we have in our space, are developing our own people. So we spend a lot of time and effort, you know, taking the people, especially, you know, those that are sort of technically oriented, and training them to be technicians for the equipment that's on the line, sending them to trade schools, sponsoring education programs, but really be on the job learning. But that's our primary source of talent. And you know, it's tough to get new people right now, especially in I'd say Southeast. It's real tough to get people. So investing in training your people is critical for retention, and you know, it makes good business sense because it helps us fill some gaps that we just can't fill externally.
Great. Can I follow that up with another question?
Sure.
To you specifically, Bruce, I was at the assembly show in Chicago, and you had a speaker there talking about your facility in Indianapolis.
Okay.
Apparently, you guys have a very futuristic facility that you guys have been working on, harnessing Industry 4.0. Do you guys offer tours to students or to colleges or whatnot to go into that sort of environment and see sort of the new and the future factory versus the old traditional?
We have, sure we have. But, you know, I would say we're in the very early stages of, like, what we would say Industry 4.0. There's an awful lot that we don't know. But we're doing a number of different pilot programs around enhanced automation, around the analytics of big data. But we're really in, you know, our industries, I think, you know, I've heard that we're sort of in the pack, but I feel like it's something that we're not nearly where we need to be.
So to follow up on that, Bruce is on the leading edge. Industry did not do a great job at training our own. And it's one of the reasons that we have such a large number of open positions today. When we talk about, or when we hear the great news that the unemployment rate is at one of the lowest points that it's been in a number of years, what's missing from that are those who are either underemployed or who've dropped out of the workforce because they feel they can no longer contribute. I don't think that there's anything more devastating to our psyche as the greatest nation on earth than those who feel that they can no longer contribute because they think technology has moved beyond their capabilities. We have an obligation as the manufacturing sector to invest in training, and thank you, Bruce, for doing that, to invest in training those who may not have quite the skills that are needed for today's technology and tomorrow's technology, but who have really contributed to our sector over the years. We're committed to doing that at the NAM. Carolyn's work with the Manufacturing Institute helps to inspire businesses to figure out exactly how to do that. Manufacturers are taking this very seriously. They're putting money into technical schools, into community colleges, into their own internal programs. And then I would end by saying the next phase where we hope we will be able to help train people while they earn and learn is the apprenticeship program that I mentioned in my remarks, because that, I think, has great possibilities for the future to help train those who may not have just exactly the right skills but have the ability to attain them.
So I think we have time for maybe one more question. The last question of the day. We're getting close to the end here.
Morning. Bill Smith from American Axle and Manufacturing. And I've got to thank Jay, first of all, for kicking off the NAM Manufacturing, State of Manufacturing Tour right here at the hub of the greatest manufacturing center. Thanks, Jay. The question is, you know, we keep hearing all the jobs are going to be displaced with robotics and automation in the plants. Maybe you could give us a few takeaways to bring with us as to why you are so confident that we're going to have these 2 million open jobs in 2025.
Yeah, I'm actually going to ask Carolyn to comment first, and I'm happy to comment as well, but she's dealing with this every single day. And it's a challenge that, it's a perception challenge, actually.
I think and it's a really good question, and this is something that comes up all the time, and I always joke, and it's this, you know, we're combating these dual challenges of manufacturing is still what it was, and that it was dirty, dark, and dangerous, and it was, it's not what it is today. It's kind of, we've had a total, complete shift, but that's also what's happening to the workforce. As automation's coming on, the jobs are shifting, your tasks are shifting. What automation is not able to replace is the critical thinking that humans bring, and also the ability to make judgments and to connect emotionally, right? And so all of that, those skills that are human in nature are still the skills that are out there. So, you know, we talk about the skills shifting, the task shifting, and also all of those robots, and Bruce, you alluded to this a little bit, they need to be programmed, they need to be fixed. They need to be told what to do. They are not innately at this time. And maybe one day, you know, that does happen, but the technology has not evolved. So what the work is doing is it's changing, which means the skills required are changing too and evolving. And then that's really what we're focused on. So it's not this wholesale displacement. Repetitive jobs are the ones that they say. Also some physically dangerous jobs. So, and that's a good thing. So what work is evolving to in that shift is actually should be a higher quality job for the humans that are doing them. And I think it's a challenge is not that it's being replaced, but how do we align the skills better? And that's really what we're talking about with a lot of companies and the educational institutions.
And you couple that with those great tools that I mentioned that we've been given by our federal government, in terms of competitive tax policy, reasonable regulations, and now hopefully an investment in infrastructure. Those are the tools that we needed to be competitive, to be able to invest in new plants and equipment, to hire new workers, to raise wages and benefits. and then the skills and the shifting of these types of jobs will be the next challenge that we have. And that's one of the reasons those 2 million vacancies will exist in the year 2025. But actually, that number was derived before we even had all those tools given to us. So that number may actually be even larger in the future.
And the biggest piece of that number, just to give, and I heard this again the other day, and every time I hear it, it blows me away. Every 9 seconds of baby boom, that is the biggest piece of the job need that we have over the next 10 years or so. The biggest part of that is the replacement of the baby boomers, but then it's also economic growth, which is a good story for all of us, but that means we have to rise to meet that challenge.
Great problems to have.
Yeah. And so I'm going to ask that we take no more questions. And before I wrap it up, so Automation Alley does know a thing or two about automation.
Yep.
And what's going to happen is the labor force is actually quite flat for the next 40 years. If you look at Department of Labor, we're not making enough people to grow our GDP and grow our standard of living. And so, and most of our manufacturing in the last 20 years, we competed with China, we competed our manufacturing away. So as production comes back to the U.S., Jay and I were talking about this, we're going to be in a wonderful golden era of manufacturing that's going to reshore because of the tax code, because of what we're able to do with technology. It's an and proposition. We can't make the stuff fast enough with the people we have. We need really smart people, and we need lots and lots of automation. Mm-hmm. So you take those two things together, and you know, we were saying how much we love our jobs. Boy, the wind is at our back in manufacturing going forward, and we'll help each other. So with that, I'd like to give Jay the last word. Is there anything left that you'd like to talk about?
Well, I think we've said it all. First and foremost, thank you again for hosting us for the kickoff. This tour is all about not only the people of manufacturing, but the people of this great country. And I mentioned those four pillars that made America an exceptional nation and continue to make us an exceptional nation today. Free enterprise, competitiveness, individual liberty, and equal opportunity. Manufacturers stand for every one of those four pillars, and we're doing everything we can to make sure that those pillars are stronger today than they were yesterday, and that they'll be stronger tomorrow than they are today. Manufacturing is key to that. There are exciting opportunities in manufacturing, so not only to the students who are assembled here, but also to the folks who are watching us on live stream, we want to invite you into the manufacturing workforce. We would love to have you connect with us again, MFGjobs to 52886, be a part of the manufacturing army, and thanks again for joining us.
It's a once-in-a-generation opportunity, says Jay Timmons.
The era of economic surrender is over, and the rebirth of American industry is beginning.
The American economy is strong.
Modern manufacturing requires a different type of skill for the future.
These are higher paid jobs. These jobs come from America.
The number of jobs are going to grow and expand.
This country of the United States was not built by those who waited and rested.